Hi, I'm Robin Beam. I'm Product Development Director here at Spellbinders. And as many of you know, I am a crafter, as many of you are, not just a paper crafter, but you do a lot of other different things. You might do crochet, as I've seen with our stitching dies, you do embroidery, sewing. There's a lot of different things that we all do. And the project that I'm going to show you today from Kathy Holden is one of those that brings all of those things together. Many of you may have seen many years ago, you might have mothers, grandmothers, or maybe even you yourself had done it. They have what they call vintage greeting card bowls. If you look that up on YouTube or Google it, you're going to see these bowls that are made from vintage greeting cards. And what they would do is they would cut out the paper, punch the paper by hand or pierce it, and then crochet or sew it together. Well, I was so excited when Kathy Holden came to us and said, I really love these bowls and I would love to see if we can do some kind of a cutting die with this so that you don't have to do all that other arduous task of having to trace and pierce. You can just get to making the finished product so much more quickly. So what I am going to show you is Kathy's two new SKUs of vintage handcrafted bowls. And we're going to have some fun today with me showing you how to do these. What we have here are two sets of dies. We have the vintage hexagon base and side bowl. So there are these two dies here. And we also have the vintage handcrafted square base and sides. There's two different sides. Now, what is great about these? This is a new product for us. These are deep etch dies. And what that means is these have a deeper cutting blade. So it's not as deep as you would get with a steel roll die, but it is deeper than what you would get in a regular etched die. So the magic of this is that it can cut out a lot more materials. You can actually cut out many layers of paper. You can cut out, you can even cut out fabric. You can cut out cardboard, as I'm going to show you. There's a lot of different things that you can cut. More on the thinner side. Don't go like crazy thick. But the other magic thing about these dies is they all interact. So these come together, but as you can see, all the holes, the way they're made up, you can also make a bowl with the one that looks like kind of like a house. Or you can make one with this rounded edge one, or you can even do one with the squares. But you can also take the square and use that as a base, and these all line up as well. So that you can get different size bowls like here. Like, see, here's the square base, and here's the rounded one. Here's another one with the square base, and that more of the one that's curved on the side. Here's when you can take all the squares, and what a neat little container that can make. And then we also have, here, I'll go to switch to this. See, here's the one that's it's kind of like the little house with the bases here. And then, as you can see, I've been making a lot of bowls. So these are both with the hexagon base, and these are the two different sides. So see how much fun they are? How great would this be for Christmas or for any time is that you make this into a little gift basket that this gets to be used again? I mean, these are just so much fun to work with. You just start going with it and it just never ends. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start to show you the magic of how to create the bases for these bowls. Believe it or not, the dollar store is your friend when it comes to making these bowls. You can go to the dollar store and get these gift boxes. These are just thin, it's thin cardboard. And this happens to be coated on one side and not coated on the other. And it's pretty thin. You don't want it too thin because you want to have some stability to it. But these are just the perfect workable surface. I mean, you can also use watercolor paper. You can use thicker other paper, but this just is made for a very nice base. So what you can do is to decorate, to create your panels, to create the bowl, there's a couple different ways to do it. One of the ways is to cut all the pieces out ahead of time. So for example, what I did, and this is with Kathy's paper pads. And for those who have worked with Kathy's paper pads, and she has some new ones for the holiday, or you can do some from her original flea market finds. This is a thinner paper. It's a little bit thinner, but that what's great about that is it's perfect for like decoupage. It's perfect for different projects where you're doing a lot of different things with, if it's gluing around a corner. It's just a really nice weight. Well, I found if you wanted to do these ahead of time and then you glue them together, I was able to actually cut six layers of this paper with the deep etch dies. So you can cut out a lot in one time. In regards to the cardboard from those gift boxes, I was able to cut out two of these at one time. So the nice thing about these deep etch dies is that you're able to get more cut through. And as you can see, one of the just beautiful things about these dies is see how perfect it is every time. You don't have to worry if you're doing these by hand. You don't have to worry, oh, are these lined up right? Oh, are these too small? Is the holes too big? Are they too far apart? All of this work has been done for you. And then all you have to do is you take two pieces and you glue them together. And you can do that for all your different layers. Now, what you can do is before you cut these out, if you wanted to, and I'll show you this with others, you can add stickers. The stickers are thin enough. Again, you have to realize that if you keep adding things on, it is going to get too thick at some point for these deep etch dies. For example, the ephemera, this is some of Kathy's Christmas flea market finds ephemera. If you start layering things on and then running it through together, it might be too thick. So I would say add on ephemera afterwards. You can glue that on afterwards and it's not a problem. But the stickers, you can definitely, because these are thin, you can definitely add those on to the paper and then die cut if you'd like. Now, the other way I like to do these is I'll create the sheets and I will glue the paper onto a panel of cardboard. So I've cut this to the size of the paper. It's 6x9. And what I do is I usually pick like a pattern paper for the front and then maybe a base paper for the back. So like I can take this for my front and then maybe go with a pattern. Some of these patterns are just so much fun. You know, let's do the Merry Christmas one. And I can do that for the back. Now, one of the newer products that we're bringing in, which is one of Kathy Holden's recommended products, is Cocoina. I had to look that up. We both had to look that up. It's Cocoina glue. It's from Italy, and it's got this lovely scent. It's this almond scent, and we have it in a glue stick, and we have it in this jar, and there's this little brush. So what you do is, this glue is so cool. It is, when you put it onto the paper, you'll immediately see it almost melts to the paper. See how it gets like shiny? It's like butter on here. It's almost like you are doing toast. And so what you're going to do is you're just going to add the glue. Notice I'm on a nonstick piece of craft sheet. And this really tends to bond to the paper. I mean, you can use whatever is your favorite glue to use. That's fine, but this glue I have found really does work nice. You know, I make sure I've got like some paper towels and stuff to clean off my sheet, but you know, you get that on and then you lay it down and see, it's all lined up. So just about. And it does dry nicely. You don't get you don't really get wrinkles. It dries very flat and it really doesn't make it bulky. And then what you would do is you would repeat for the other side. So I have one here that I've done already. So what I want to do next is I decide which of these dies that I want to cut out for my bowl. So let me do this one, the one that kind of looks like a house. So what I'll do is I might find an area that I like, and I'm going to be adding some stickers and things to this. So I'm going to trim it and then see, I have the other side. So I always try to remember, where's my top and bottom? And this is where I can start adding some of the stickers in. Again, you don't have to do this, but this is the fun of it. And you can also use wrapping paper if you want. You can use old vintage cards that you may have. I mean, there's no limit to what you can use to make these bowls. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna line this up. Now, what you wanna determine is, what do you want to be your outside and what do you want to be your inside? So the outside to me is the nice side. And not that this is a bad side, but this is the side that face that you're gonna place the die on. And what I'm gonna do is just cut this. Now, the one thing I want you to be aware of, if your muscles are a little on the weaker side, you may want to do the layering, the cutting everything separate and gluing them together. This, it is a little thicker because we've added, to see, it doesn't take that much effort. But again, because this is the deep etch die, what I'm able to do, and then I just get my tweezers and I just clean this out. But look how nice this is. And the other thing that seems to happen, the pressure from the die cut machine really seems to press everything together. So just to recap, what you can do is one of two ways. When you cut, you can either cut everything individually and then glue them together. So you just would sandwich it with the cardboard. Or the other way is to create your sheets and then cut them. Then you can add your stickers, then cut them out, and then you're ready to go that way. Either way works. Do whatever works best for you. So now I'm going to show you a few different ways to put the bowls together. Even if you've not crocheted, even if you've not done stitching, you can do this. It's very simple. One of the pieces of packaging that I have here, you'll see we have a blanket stitch. I think there's blanket stitch here, but here it's just laced together. You're just lacing. So you can do it a lot of different ways. I'm going to show you, this is the same bowl. So this is the blanket stitch, and this is crochet. And these are the same types of threads used, but you can see this is a little more full. This is still very nice. It's a nice effect. It just depends on the thread that you're going to use, which I'm going to show you something new that we have that might make it more full. But these both give similar effects. So one of the new things that we're going to be carrying is hemp cord. And this is number 10 hemp cord, and it comes in three colors. This is white, and for hemp cord, this is white, black, and red. And this can be used for like any crafts, but it also makes wonderful effects when you're working with a blanket stitch for these bowls. So what I'm going to do is I have a piece of the white. Now, if you're new to this, you may not want to go super long with the thread because it'll tend to want to knot up on you. But if you're patient and go slow, it's really very easy to work with. So I have, I believe this is like a tapestry needle. You want something that's not pointy. And usually what I do is I start, this is considered the bottom, and this is just the way I work. And I don't start right in the middle. I start over here. Every one of these in the middle here, not a corner, is going to get three stitches. But what I do on that first hole is I only do two stitches, because when I come back and finish it and put the third stitch here, it's going to have a more finished look. So it's kind of one of those trust me. You also want to decide which do you want to be your side. Like, this is the good side. You can usually tell because of the embossing that happens when you cut through. This side, it's more flat and sharper edged. So this would be what's going to go on the inside of the basket. This is the outside of the basket. This is the more finished side that's going to face out. So this is why you have it facing up. So what I'm going to do is run this through, and you create it, and you hold on to a tail, and I'll put the tail just over here. Now this again is for the blanket stitch. And if you are not familiar with a blanket stitch, you can look it up online, but it's just simple. It's simple working your thread through a loop. So what I've done here is I've run it back through the same hole, and see I have a loop here? I'm going to run that needle through that loop and then tighten it up. Now the first stitch always looks weird. So again, I have my thread with the tail. I'm going to run, I'm going to continue to hold that tail so that I'm, as I'm doing my stitch, it's going to keep it down. So I'm running through here, and see, I created my loop. I'm running through that loop again. All right, and see what happens? It catches it. Again, I going from the back up, and when I pull it, I again have a loop. All right, so now I'm gonna go down through that loop. And see what that does by way of this blanket stitch? It creates like a little border around the edge. So I'm gonna do three stitches of this. Again, up from the bottom, create a loop, down through the loop. Because of the nature of this hemp cord, it catches it nice, and you also see how it really fills the hole, and it makes for a very nice stitch going around. When you get to the corner, you are going to repeat, but you're going to do six stitches. So as I go through, once you get going, and yes, I count to myself six, because sometimes I'm not paying attention. So two, and again, see up, create the loop, through the loop, tighten it up. So now I'm kind of turning the corner here, and I'm just going to continue. That's four, five. See how that goes around so nicely? Six. All right, again, there's my loop. Go through the loop. So you're going to just continue that all the way around. And then when you get back here, you're going to do your third stitch, and you're going to finish that off. And so that's how you're going to end up doing this. Now, when you're going to sew these together for the blanket stitch, it's a little easier when you put them together. And I'll explain this when I show you with the crochet. But as you're making these, see that little crossover here from this hole to this hole? That's what you're going to use to loop these together, to sew these together. And it makes it very easy to sew these. But I can show you that when it comes to working on the crochet. The crochet is a little different, but in the end, it all kind of works out the same. So here, again, I go up. There's my loop, go back down through the loop and create the blanket stitch. So that's one way to do this with a needle and thread. The other way is, my favorite way, is crochet. And as you can see how these come together, see it gets a fuller look. And when you sew these together, it just makes for a fuller, beautiful effect. Now the thread that I'm using, there is crochet thread out there. If you probably can use a yarn, but yarn sometimes is too thick. The hemp cord is probably too thick for this, and it's harder to use with a crochet hook. So you don't want to use this. But this is like from DMC. It's called Petra, and it's I found that number 5 is nice. There's a 10, there's a 3. you basically, you can first start out with what you may have at home. And I know you all have it some at home. And you can work with this. But it turns out that it comes in a lot of really nice colors. And it's not too thin. And it's nice to work with. So what I'm going to show is also the crochet hook would help. I use a number 0, which is a 1.75 millimeter. Again, work with what you're comfortable with. You don't want something that is going to be too thick for going through the holes, because then it's just going to, you're going to end up mangling it. But this goes through very nicely. All right. So as I had told, we'll do the cream. I think that'll come up against the dark. This is basically just a single crochet. And if you've ever done just making a chain, you make a loop, you go through, you make a loop. This is basically all you're doing with this. So what you're going to do, again, the side that you want to be the nice side. Here's a finished one. See how you can see it almost looks like a braid? It's like the little V's that you see on a top of crochet. This is the side that faces out. This is considered, this is the back side. So this will be inside of the bowl. All right. Because when we sew these together, this top part is important for when we join two sides together. So what you're going to do is, again, you want to have a bit of a tail. And I'm going to be going through with the crochet hook from the top to the back. And what I'm doing is I'm going to grab the crochet thread. And I'm just going to run it through. And so see, I have a loop now. See, I have a loop. All right. I'm going to take the thread again from the top, hook it, and pull it through. That's it. That's all I'm doing. Tighten that up. So the first couple might be a little weird. So again, I'm going to create a loop, bring it through the hole, loop it. So now I have two loops on. I have the third loop I'm going through, and that's it. So I'm doing two on the first hole. Then I'm going to the next, and again, I'm holding onto my thread, my tail, because I'm going to like basically sew that in. So again, through. See, I have the loop here, and I still have the loop here. I'm going to yarn over, as they say. So crochet thread over, and you're going to go through those two loops. Okay. Yarn over. You have two loops on the hook. You grab and you yarn over here. And you go through those two. Once you get going with it, it's really very easy. No one yell at me right now. I've done a lot of these at this point. So when you get to your corners, you're going to, again, do six. So for this one, I'll do six on these corners and this corner. This is a little bit of a softer corner, so I'll do like five on this one. All right. So I'm just going to continue around, again, from the top to the bottom, grab the yarn, make a loop. I have two loops, yarn over through the two loops. So I'm going to do six around the corner. This is the perfect watch TV thing to do. All right. And what's nice about this thread, it doesn't separate. And it doesn't like shred sometimes. How some threads or yarns are too many plies to it. This holds together very nicely. And so at some point, what I'll do is I'll probably like see here. I can cut off the thread. Sometimes I'll go down further. It just depends on my mood. And I'll just trim this down. And then I'll just continue through. So again, one more time. I have one loop on the hook I go into the hole, grab the thread, run it through. So now I have two, yarn over, and go through those two loops. So see how that creates that nice little, from the crochet, that nice little V on the top? So you're going to continue to do that. And then once you get, so here's one that I got all the way to the end. So see here, oops, let me put that back in. All right. I have two here. Let's finish. All right. This is one that I did previously. Another thing I meant to tell you, when you're finishing your panels, if you want to make it more of a waterproof, you can do like matte liquid gel or something as a finish on top of it on both sides. But some of this, these hold up very well. All right. So see, I have two stitches on this last hole. So I want to do the third one here. All right. So then what I'm going to do is take, do like a slip knot. So see, I ran that through. So see how this is just kind of hanging here? What I'm going to do is I'm going to take my needle and I'm going to finish this off, and it just makes for a nice effect. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to turn this over and see here, there's these stitches. These are the ones I just added. I'm going to slide that through, and look how, when I pull it, look how nice that, look how that finishes off. See how nice that looks? Once I finish that, I put that through. So what you're going to do is you are going to keep a thread, a tail. Sometimes I keep them a little longer, and this is when it gets a little hairy because you've got a lot of threads hanging. So what you're going to do is, but there's a method to the madness. So what you want to do sometimes is you do want to figure out what you want your design to look like, especially if you're repeating patterns. You don't want to have one next to the other, which I've done sometimes not paying attention. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take one of the panels that I finished, and I'm going to line it up. And this, sometimes I have to think twice about this, but what you're going to do is you're going to take the right side out against the other piece right side out. So see? All right. Now, if you look carefully, remember I talked about the V's? There's a V that goes on either side of this. What you're going to do is the V that's toward the middle, the half of the V toward the middle on this side, is going to sew into the other, the V, the half of the V on the other side. When you look at these closely, it makes sense. You don't want to go over the whole thing. It's just going to make it look bulky. What you see that what you're doing is the two V's on either side, when you're sewing just the one half of it together, it creates this really nice, neat finish. And it's also easier to sew on the outside as opposed to trying to sew on the inside of the bowl as you're building it. So to start, what you're going to do is you're going to be sewing the sides to the base. And to do that, you're going to use the tail that's on the base piece, and you're going to go all around. So again, as I had said, what you're going to do is it's the outside, right side of the bottom of the bowl is going to back up to the back of the other side. So the nice sides are facing out on both sides. And here's my tail. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to just start sewing from one half of the V to the other. And you're just going to go all the way up. And you just keep going through. And as you get it, usually it's funny, your fingers will, or and your eyes will line up the threads like when the next two are, and it goes pretty quickly. See? You know, I'll pull it this way, so it just continues. So I'll continue to do that until I get to the end. And then when I get to the end, what I'll do is I'll then take the next one and just remember, right sides are out. And then I'll just continue around. And then what happens is you end up with this. And as I had indicated before, I have a lot of threads, but it's all good. Once you finish the base, you wind that base off, and you'll see you have a separate thread for each side of your box. So then all you have to do, you don't have to worry about weaving in another thread because they're there already, because you kept the tail from each one of your outside bowl panels. So what you're going to then do is continue what I had just shown, and you're going to put these together. Now, when you at the corner, sometimes I'll go through the corners a little more to just reinforce them a couple times so that I don't have a gap. And then what you do is you'll sew it up the side. And then what I do is I weave through here. I weave through these stitches here. And, you know, I'll do it a few times so that you don't want it to get loose. So see how that is? You have plenty of area that you can pull that through. And so what happens, you're basically zipping up the sides and you're going to have this awesome bowl. So again, as you can see, when you put these together, so it's these inside loops that are on either side of the box. Those are the sides that you're going to sew together. I just wanted to use the crochet hook because it might be a little easier to see. If you're a crocheter or do some any needlecraft, you'll understand what I'm saying. So as you can see, after a while, you will be making a lot of bowls. And you'll find a lot of uses for them. I mean, you can put your craft supplies in. You can put your keys in. You can make these as gift baskets. And you're going to find that they're just so much fun to do. And Kathy has her products, the stamps, the stickers, the paper, the ephemera, that all can be used. But you can make these look whatever style that you want. If you want them pink with purple polka dots, you can do that because there's a thread for that. There is so much freedom and fun as to the fact that with these deep etch dies that you can now cut deeper materials and make these things. It just opens up the world to so many fun things that you can do. And it's just in time for the holidays in regards to how you can make these as gifts for people, and then make them for yourself too. I mean, how wonderful would these be for your Christmas cards to put in there? And then you can use those Christmas cards to make more of your handcrafted vintage bowls from Kathy Holden. I have another little surprise bonus. This is something that I figured out very recently, and it is perfect for the vintage handcrafted bowls. What do you think this is made of? I will tell you, it's our 3D embossing folders, but it's not leather, it's paper. We'll probably do a video on this, but this is just another project that you can make to create the look of hand-tooled leather using some paper, ink, and a little bit of other surprises. I know it was a kind of a quick overview of what I did, but I'm more than happy to answer questions. And there's a lot of information out there about how to crochet, how to do blanket stitch. You know now how to do the surfaces with the cardboard. These are going to be great projects for you to make for yourself and for everyone else. And as I always say, have fun.